your cloud, and we should be good to go. So we were in section 1.3, and we're still in section 1.3. And again, this might be a review. I'll bet this stuff gets talked about in calculus 3, but let's talk about vectors on the plane. So most sort of real world vectors can't be visualized in any meaningful way, because most real world vectors have like 50 elements at a minimum if they're going to be used for anything. But we're going to look briefly at vectors in R2. And remember what we mean by that. We're looking at column vectors, and this 2 up here is saying that we have 2 rows. So we're looking at vectors in R2. And maybe it occurs to us that a vector in R2 is just an ordered list of 2 numbers. And we have a way to visually represent ordered lists of 2 numbers. And that's the Cartesian plane. I mean, if instead of a vector, we had the point 1, 2, and we wanted to represent that point visually, we would be able to do so. Well, we can represent vectors visually as well. And the way we do this is pretty straightforward. We start as if we're drawing a point. So to visually represent the vector 1, 2, we draw the point 1, 2. And then we connect the origin to the point with an arrow, emanating from the origin and ending at the point. And as I say, most vectors aren't vectors in the plane, but the geometric intuition we get from this is very important, and it's very valuable, even if we're looking at vectors in R50 and we can't graph anything. Because what sort of geometric intuition we should be gleaning from this is that vectors have directions. This vector is pointing somewhere. And the other piece of geometric intuition we should be gleaning from this is that vectors have lengths. This is a line segment, it has a length. Any line segment on the plane does. So vectors have directions, and vectors have lengths. Once again, even like vectors in R50 or R100, where you can no longer visualize what a direction or what a length would be. And we'll talk about both these things later in the course. For now, let's use the observation that vectors have lengths to try to get a little intuition about scalar multiplication. So I've said that we can multiply vectors by real numbers. And I've called this scalar multiplication, and that's because in this context, the real number we're multiplying by is called a scalar. And I said that to do this multiplication, you simply take the elements of the vector and multiply them all by the scalar. But why scalar? Scalar presumably comes from the word scale. And this becomes intuitively clearer if we look at the vector 1, 3 graphically. So always bearing in mind that I am a math professor and not an art professor, and the quality of my graphs perhaps reflects that. As far as I can draw this thing to scale, here it is. Here is the vector 1, 3. And here is the vector 2, 6. And if you compare 1, 3, and 2, 6, the first thing you might notice is that the directions are the same. So multiplying 1, 3 by a scalar changed the vector clearly. You look at this and you look at this and they're not the same, but it didn't change the direction of the vector. It's still pointing in the same way. And the next thing you might notice, assuming that this drawing is good enough to sort of show this, is that the vector 2, 6 is twice as long as the vector 1, 3. Scalar multiplication by 2 doubled the length. Phrasing that a little more formally, scalar multiplication by 2 scaled, there's that word, the length, by a factor of 2. So there's where that word scalar comes from. It's because scalar multiplication keeps the direction of the vector constant, but it scales its length out or in. Let's try to summarize this neatly. Scalar multiplication by a scalar K, based solely on what we've seen here, appears to do the following. It appears to leave the direction unchanged, but this statement is going to get a big old asterisk next to it. We're going to come back to that. And it multiplies the length of the vector by k. And this is also, if there we go, if the whiteboard wants to cooperate, this is also going to get an asterisk next to it. And both those asterisks come from the same thing. If k is positive, then these statements are just flatly true. These asterisks go away, but they can't be true as stated if k is negative. Like statement two, lengths have to be positive. If you take a length and you multiply it by a negative number, you'd get a negative length. So statement two just flatly cannot be true if your scalar is negative. And what happens if your scalar is negative? Say you've got this vector here and you multiply it by negative two. Multiplication by a negative number is going to reverse the direction of the matrix. Not matrix, sorry. It's going to reverse the direction of the this whiteboard really doesn't like dotted lines, but there we go. It's going to reverse the direction of the vector so that instead of going up in this direction, it's going to go down in this direction. And it's going to scale the length of the vector by two. So let me see if I can do this. Here's the length of the vector. Here's the length of the vector once. Okay, so if we multiply it by negative two, we should end up with a vector that looks something like that. I don't know how exact this is, but my goal was to make this vector twice as long as this vector. So if we wanted to summarize that, when k is negative, it reverses the direction and it scales not by k, but by the absolute value of k. And that's sort of, that's what I would say is the most important part of planar geometry. There is the parallelogram rule. We might as well say this. I think the parallelogram rule kind of needs a little context to make it useful. Let's look at just basic non-vector addition. 2 + 3 = 5. Let's take a look at that statement. You could understand this statement in terms of the number line in the following way. If we've got a number line and here's 0, and here's two. And we've got a number line, and here's zero, and here's three. Then we can think of adding two and three simply in terms of taking this segment of the number line and sticking it on to the end of this segment of the number line. You just take those line segments, you stick them together, and you get a line segment of length 5. The parallelogram rule says that vector addition works the same way. If you have two vectors in R2 and you're adding them together, we just take this vector and we move it. Tip to tail is the phrase we use here. And this vector is the sum. And it's called the parallelogram rule because addition is commutative, right? So in addition to taking this vector and moving it here, we could take this vector and move it tip to tail. And we'd wind up with this parallelogram. So if this is the vector V and this is the vector W, this is the vector V plus W. And just like you would not add 2 and 3 by moving segments of the number line around, you would not, in practical situations, add vectors by moving them around the Cartesian plane. We already have a method of adding vectors. If we want to add 1 and 2 with 5 and 7, we don't need to mess around with parallelograms. We just physically add 1 and 5, 2 and 7. So this is more a conceptual result than a clearly applicable result. But it is a useful conception to have. It will show up occasionally throughout the semester that we can think of vector addition merely as moving the vectors around. Now we'll get into some stuff that I guess I don't actually know what's taught in Calculus 3, but maybe some newer definitions. If we have vectors, let's call them V and W, we can add them. And we can multiply them by scalars. So an expression like 3v plus w makes sense. It's the scalar product of v with 3 plus vector addition w. Definition. A linear combination of vectors is, well, anything of the form a scalar times a vector plus another scalar times another vector going out as far as we want. We can have a linear combination of two vectors. We can have a linear combination of a million vectors. And in this linear combination, these scalars C get a special name. They're called the weights of the vectors. Similarly to how we can write down linear equations, sorry, linear combinations, we can write down equations involving vectors. So, for example, let's look at an equation C1 times 1, negative 2, negative 5, plus C2 times 2, 5, 6 equals 7, 4, negative 3. And a solution to such an equation would be a value of C1 and a value of C2. That satisfies this equality. So a value of C1 and a value of C2 that make this equality true. And you might think, okay, so a few days ago it was systems of linear equations, and we learned this whole method, Gauss-Jordan elimination, to solve systems of linear equations. Now it's vector equations, sorry. And we're going to have to learn a method to solve vector equations. That could get pretty tedious pretty fast, but it's not what is going to happen. It turns out that we can use Gauss-Jordan elimination to solve vector equations as well. So we're not going to have to master a whole new technique. And why is that? Well, that's do the addition, and let's do the scalar multiplication on the left-hand side of this equality. One, I know I'm blocking the screen, but if I try to stand here and write, it's going to be completely unreadable. One C1 plus two eraser plus 2C2, negative 2C1 plus 5C2, negative 5C1 plus 6C2. There. I just did the scalar multiplication and addition. And this is equal to 7, 4, -3. So this vector equality is the same as saying one vector is equal to another vector. The vector on the left is equal to the vector on the right. Everyone following along so far? Well, two vectors are equal if they're of the same size and if their components are equal. So for this vector to equal this vector, those first components have to be equal. Those second components have to be equal. And those third components have to be equal. And when we write down each of those equalities, 1c1 plus 2c2 equals 7, -2c1 plus 5c2 equals 4, -5c1 plus 6c2 equals -3. What do you have but a system of linear equations that you can solve using Gauss-Jordan elimination? And here is where we are going to pause, and we are going to teach you to do Gauss-Jordan elimination on your calculator. Because doing this by hand every time it comes up is not feasible. So how do I want to do this? Let's see, I have a video for my online students of this already. I'm to pause the recording if I, gosh, this is finicky. If I can pause the recording, there we go. Unmute myself, and let's state this kind of as a theorem. So if you have a vector equation that you want to solve, then this is solved with Gauss-Jordan elimination on the vector that had the matrix, sorry, that has these vectors as its columns. So demonstrating this by going back a few slides, we had this matrix equation. I keep saying that and getting ahead of myself by like one section. We have this vector equation. We wanted to solve it. What we ended up doing was taking those vectors, making them the columns of a matrix and performing Gauss-Jordan elimination on that matrix. One more definition before we're through with this section. An equation like this might have solutions, it might not have solutions. That will be reflected when you perform the Gauss-Jordan elimination. You could have one solution or no solutions or infinitely many solutions, just as with a system of linear equations. The span of some vectors V1 up to Vn is all the vectors B. So the span is a set of vectors such that the vector equation C1 V1 plus C2 V2 up to Cn Vn equals B has a solution. So going back to our previous example, this vector 7, 4, -3 is in the span. Here's our notation, by the way, just the word span, then the curly brackets. It's in the span of 1, -2, -5, and 2, 5, 6. And we know that it's in the span because this equation had a solution. And if you ever want to know whether one vector is in the span of other vectors, you just set the equation up, solve it using Gauss-Jordan elimination, and see what happens. If you get a solution, it's in the span. That is it for 1.3. 1.4 is important but brief. We should be able to finish that this class period. I'm going to make this a separate video.